Good afternoon, and welcome to the Your Town television program on AMP's Access Monterey Peninsula Cable Channel 24 and on the internet at ampmedia.org. Every weekday at 5 o'clock, we are proud to have as our guests various local civic and community leaders. The purpose of the program is to help inform listeners and viewers like you about some of the things going on in your town. And now, on with the program.
Hello, welcome to the Your Town program. My name is Steve Ellzey. I am your host today and every second Monday of the month. We have a wonderful program today. We have Tim Thomas from Monterey Waterfront Cannery Row Tours. We also have Chris Scholin, who is here from Imbari. And let's get right with it, because you're going to hear some wonderful history right now. Tim Thomas, welcome to Your Town.
Thank you, Steve. I appreciate it.
Oh, it's great to have you here. I always enjoy listening to you. And let's take a little historical tour. Let's start out with Monterey. I love your story about how Monterey got its name and how it got founded.
Well, you know, there's a lot of confusion about how Monterey got its name, but actually in 1602, a guy by the name of Sebastian Vizcaino was on a mission from Spain to sail along the California coast to find safe ports from those big galleons returning from the Philippines. If you remember that story, in 1565, Spain found a route that took them across the Pacific from Mexico that landed right in the middle of Manila Bay. And when they got to Manila was like this kind of gigantic Walmart, had all this really cool stuff. You know, stuff from Japan and stuff from China and stuff from the Spice Islands, you know, stuff they really wanted to have. And they had all the silver from Mexico that those guys wanted to have, so they began trading. But they had to find a way to come home. I mean, you couldn't come back the same way you came because you're fighting these currents. It took them a couple of years, but eventually found this route that pushed them across the Pacific. The Chinese call that the Black Tide or the Big Drain. Comes out somewhere in Northern California, Mendocino County. They turned right, sailed down the California coast. But this trip can be very dangerous. I mean, it can take weeks, it can take months in some cases. There were storms, there was diseases, and there was scurvy, and scurvy was an awful thing. So they had to find safe ports where these guys could stop and make repairs and take on fresh supplies and fresh water and really just rest. That was Vizcaino's job. Outfitted with a special ship called the Caravel, a little galleon that was designed to stay along the coast. Sailed along this California coast, came into the Monterey Harbor in December of 1602. Had to an absolutely beautiful day or he would have missed this place altogether.
Sure.
Camped up on the hill above the wharf that we call Presidio Hill and spent a couple of weeks here and loved this place and named it after his sponsor, the Count de Monterey. I thought was pretty smart on his part because you're supposed to name any newly discovered land after a saint, right? San Diego? No, he named it after a guy that was paying his bill.
He was a good businessman too, huh?
Yeah, well, he wanted to settle Monterey then, wanted to be named governor, but Spain had other issues. They had some war issues and some financial issues, so they backed off a little bit. In fact, it took them about 170 years to get back here.
Well, you know, I think we have a picture. Can we go to picture number one? Believe it or not, I found a picture of the Viceroy de Monterey.
There he is, right there. In fact, there is a Monterey castle in Spain that you can visit.
Ah, the Castillo de Monterey, Okay. Now, when he got here, what did he see? What was it like
Well,
then?
Actually, it was a pretty abundant place. You know, it's interesting because he wrote a diary. There were a couple of priests aboard with him that also kept diaries. And over the years, he got a lot of people discounted what he said. But truth is, we believe Monterey was pretty accurate as how he described it. A lot of pine trees, a lot of animal life. In fact, he describes seeing grizzly bears on the beach eating whale as he comes in, which was a fairly common thing.
Sure.
But just huge amounts of birds, and in fact, so many birds they said you couldn't see the surface of the little lakes. I mean, it was just an incredibly abundant place when he was here. It was also really cold when he was here. It was in December, and anybody who lives here knows we don't get a lot of those really cold winters, but evidently it was the time he was here. He talks about his water bottles freezing over, like an inch of ice overnight.
My goodness, yeah. That does not sound like the kind of winters we usually have.
Not often, every once in a while, but...
Now, I wonder if that's why it was so clear then when he got here.
You know, that's a good point. It could have been. I don't know.
Now, how about the indigenous people?
Sure.
Who was here there? And maybe we could go to picture sure. number three, Jim.
Sure. So the native people were the Rumsean people. Rumsean was the native that they spoke, a language that they spoke. Vizcaino talked about them, visiting him every single day at his campsite. They brought him seeds and abalone and different kinds of things.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people have heard the term alone, you know.
Yes.
In the world of words, alone is kind of a new word. I mean, a little over 100 years old or so.
Mm.
And saying you're alone is kind of like saying I'm from Europe. But Ohlone territory with a stretch from San Francisco Bay along the coast all the way down past Point Sur. And then within that are a number of different tribes.
Okay.
Monterey were the Rumsean people.
Ah, okay.
It was the language that they spoke.
Mm-hmm.
And we can trace native peoples into the Monterey area about 5,000 years. And as I mentioned, for them anyway, it was a pretty abundant place.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, huge herds of deer and elk and tule elk and grizzly bear. I've read accounts from earlier explorers like Vizcaino and others who were coming into the Monterey area talking about the bay and saying that the bay was so filled with seals and sea lions and stellar sea lions that they actually thought that the bay was paved. I mean, they wrote into their diaries that the Monterey Bay is like a brown cobblestone.
Oh, my goodness.
Certain times of the year, waves would crash up onto the beach, pouring fish onto the beach. Literally, that's how abundant it was out there. So as far as I know, as far as I can tell, there was never any real time of hunger
mm-hmm.
For the Rumsean people.
And did they, when was an established fort here then? When did that happen?
As I mentioned, Vizcaino was here in 1602, wanted to mm-hmm. establish something then, and then because of Spain's issues, they backed off. It took about 170 years to get back here.
Really?
And then the Portola expedition arriving, they came looking from that fabled Monterey. I mean, Vizcaino had written these wonderful descriptions of it, and, you know, kind of like a big postcard that sat on a big refrigerator somewhere in Mexico all these years. I mean, we've got to go find that Monterey. And so they launched an expedition in 1769 from Mexico, but they're walking. You know, walking and sailing are two different things.
Yes.
And so their expedition actually overshot Monterey. Actually, ended up over by Salinas, by the Salinas River in the fall of 1769, and sent a couple of soldiers by horseback. And they actually rode along the beach all the way. We know they ended up at the beach near what we now call the beach down by the Monterey Wharf down there.
Del Monte, sure.
Yeah, and they sit down that beach going, this doesn't look like the Monterey that Vizcaino had described. Well, I mean, it was 170 years later.
Okay.
And also, probably wasn't a lot of water in the rivers as there was when Vizcaino was here. So they went back, and they continued north, actually in San Francisco, realized they had gone too far, turned around, came all the way back.
Mm-hmm.
The whole group of them stood on that same beach here in Monterey, scratched their heads, said, man, this does not look like Monterey. Killed a couple of donkeys to eat, and
uh-huh.
went back to San Diego, realized they were in Monterey, turned around and came all the way back, and finally established a settlement here in 1770.
Oh, okay.
And so the town of Monterey, well, it wasn't really a town, but they built a settlement here and built a fort,
okay.
A presidio that we call, and where they pretty much confined themselves to this presidio. They were a little concerned about leaving the walls of that little presidio there.
Now, I had heard they named it El Castillo de Monterey. And let's go to picture five, Jim, if we could. And
sure.
Was that because Monterey lived in his castle? Is that what that meant?
Well, the El Castillo actually was up above where the Presidio Hill is now.
Oh, okay.
So, and they had some gun placements and stuff up there that they put up there later.
Oh,
But the initial fort was really down where the San Carlos Church is, and that was
really?
The Presidio area all in there, and it was all walled off.
Uh-huh.
And they pretty much stayed within that area there.
Now, when did Father Serra and the missionaries come? Was that in the 1700s
at the same time? Whole mission system. I mean, the whole reason that they're beginning to settle in California was a couple reasons. They wanted to settle more land, but mm-hmm. also to establish this mission system, a series of missions along the California coast,
right.
You know, to Christianize these Indians. That was the whole point of it, right?
Mm-hmm.
San Diego, I think, was first. Monterey was really the second, became the main mission. And initially here in Monterey, where San Carlos Church is. And then because of political issues, because Sarah did not get along with the government here in Monterey at that time.
Really?
Oh, no, they did not get along at all. And mm-hmm. because they had other, you know, the government in Monterey at that time really thought we should just leave the native people alone. They had their own form of government. They were peaceful people. They weren't really bothering anybody. But, you know, of course, Sarah's mission was to Christianize these folks. And
sure.
So he broke away from that, and that's why he moved to Carmel.
Mm-hmm.
And, just to get away from that whole part of it. And also, he launched a pretty good campaign to get rid of that government that was in Monterey at that time.
Wait a minute.
Yeah.
Are you telling me that Father Sarah was an activist?
Oh, he was very active in that term. So, so he did. So the native people were heavily impacted by the missions, of course. They were immediately taken into these missions.
Mm-hmm.
And really affected their lives. And a lot.
Now, Jim, could you go to number six, please? Because this is a drawing that I found.
Oh,
and
a beautiful drawing, yeah, yeah.
Now, and it's, I think it's an older drawing,
yep.
too.
This was done in the early 1800s.
And so is that a view of the mission where the current mission church
no,
is?
No, I think this is Monterey, down by the San Carlos.
Okay, so
area.
They're looking down
yeah.
into the Monterey
yeah.
area.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
All right. Well,
it's good. What's interesting to me is when the Spanish settled here, they were convinced that Monterey was going to be like Spain, and they were going to raise crops and all kinds of things here. Well, they did an archaeological dig when they restored the San Carlos Church the last few years.
Mm-hmm.
What they found in terms of what the people were eating initially were, of course, they were eating seafood. They're eating a lot of fish.
Oh,
you know,
okay.
That was a big part of how they never understood how to utilize this land here. I mean, Monterey literally was like a gigantic Safeway, fully stocked. Except for the Spain did not have the key to get in. And
okay.
So they really relied on those native people to keep them alive. They would go out and hunt and fish for them. There's a famous story of Winipro Serra returning from a trip to Mexico City, back to the Carmel Mission, finding his soldiers literally starving to death, living on chickpeas and goat's milk. And they would send the native people out, you know, to hunt fish, kept them alive down there.
So they did not know how to hunt and fish, and it's kind of amazing when you consider
right.
that the salad bowl
right.
of the world is right
yeah.
over the mountain
yeah.
or right over the hill
right.
there, and there wasn't a lot of agriculture then established with them.
Well, they were raising
them.
Tobacco, they were raising grapes here, they wanted to raise wheat and stuff, but wheat, I don't think, took too well here in
no.
this climate. But they're also, but people don't know, the very first cannery in the Monterey area actually was at the Carmel Mission. So,
really?
So in the late 1770s, there was a huge smelt run running up that Carmel River, and native people came from all over to grab the smelt, and they brought it into the mission where they were actually putting it in barrels of salt. They were canning it and shipping it to Mexico.
Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah.
And that was the first Cannery Row.
Was
that the mission?
Was that the Carmel Mission?
We're going to talk about Cannery Row
right.
later. But now what happened then in the 1800s?
Right.
There was an admiral who came into
sure.
the bay.
Right.
And I think he was an American admiral.
Right, there was.
Sure.
Sloat. Commodore Sloat. But even before Sloat, there was a guy named A.P. Catesby Jones, who was then commander of the Pacific.
Okay.
So the United States always had its eyes on California. We've heard that term of manifest destiny, from sea to shining sea, that we're
sure.
going to own all both coasts, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so that Navy commander of the Pacific always had standing orders that if we ever went to war with Mexico, that you're supposed to sail your ships into Monterey, because Monterey was the, of course, capital for the outpost, northern outpost of Mexico then at that point.
Okay.
And Catesby Jones, a few years before Commodore Sloat here, had heard that we had gone to war with Mexico and sailed his ships into Monterey and unloaded his Marines. They came and raised the flag over that El Castillo American flag, and then the next day they found out we weren't at war with Mexico and they had to give the flag back. It was kind of embarrassing for him. but I think the United States learned a lesson from that. They learned a lot about that. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was pretty easy to do, is what they learned, to come and take Monterey.
Oh.
There are some historians who believe that was actually something that was probably planned to see what kind of reaction they would get.
Sort of a practice? A practice run, you mean?
Yeah, kind of. I mean,
oh,
you know,
okay.
That's, we don't know. There's some back and forth on that, but there are some who believe that was the case. So in 1846, when we did go to war with Mexico, it was Commodore John Drake Sloat, who was then commander of the Pacific. He was an older gentleman, had some mm-hmm. health issues, mm-hmm. you know, and he was off the coast, I think, of Mazatlan, and he heard these rumors, you know, because we didn't have email or CNN then, so he brought his ships up to Monterey. He was very cautious, mm-hmm. and came in around July 1st, but didn't do anything. He stayed in the ship, and because he didn't want to make the same mistake that Catesby Jones had done.
Oh,
so
okay.
So finally, Thomas Larkin, who was a merchant here in Monterey and a pretty well-regarded citizen here, finally convinced Sloat that, yeah, we were at war with Mexico. And then on July 7th, 1846, he sent his Marines in, and they raised the American flag over that custom house. But they knew we were coming. I mean, there was no, you know, they weren't, it wasn't like they were, the Mexico knew that it was going to happen. So when they
True.
Raised the flag here, there was no Mexican flag for them to take down and replace. You know,
mm-hmm.
It was bloodless, let's go, for the coup.
Okay.
So what that happened was we went to war with Mexico and then ended up owning thousands and thousands of acres of the entire West.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and then after the war, of course, Mexico ceded this part of the Northern California and all those parts of the West to the United States.
And then did they just take over the battlements? Were they able to just utilize the equipment and the cannons that were there everything else? And,
yeah.
And so they didn't.
But it wasn't a lot for them to take over. I mean,
uh-huh.
I mean, it was pretty easy. They left a guy here by name of Walter Colton. And Walter Colton was a chaplain, Navy chaplain, who came in about a week later after
mm-hmm.
Sloat was. And he loved this place. He wrote this wonderful book that I tell everybody they should read. Anybody who lives in Monterey, called My 3 Years in California, was sort of a daily journal of his life here.
Mm-hmm.
And he was sort of what they call the alcalde, kind of like the mayor and judge of Monterey. And really loved this place, and he would just write these wonderful descriptions about Monterey, and about life at that time here.
And this is the Colton at Colton Hall.
Exactly.
Was
he's
named
the guy that built
after.
Colton Hall.
Okay, and you know what? I think that we are probably going to go to break right
okay.
about now, but we will be back with Tim Thomas, and we are going to learn more, and we're going to start with Colton Hall.
Okay.
Be right back.
Just a moment with more of the Your Town television program here on AMP's cable channel 24 and on the internet at ampmedia.org.
Welcome back to the Your Town television program. My name is Steve Ellzey. I'm the executive producer with AMP, and this is the second Monday, and that's why you're seeing me here. And I'm here with Tim Thomas, who's the president of Monterey Waterfront Cannery Road Tours. Tim, thanks for being here.
Sure, thank you.
Let's get right into Colton.
Sure.
Was it Walter Colton?
Walter Colton, right.
Okay, and the Colton Hall is named after
right.
him, and something very important.
Right.
for the state of California happened.
So Walter Colton was from the East Coast, and he thought every town should have a town hall like they have in on the East Coast where he lived. And so that was his reasoning to build a building, Colton Hall. And of course, he got all the money to build it from taxes. So they would tax or fines, and that's how they raised the money. Monterey was a pretty wild place in those days. A lot of saloons, a lot of gambling, and he would go at night and go out and actually collect taxes to build that.
Oh, okay.
And so, and then after the War of Mexico and this big movement to make California a state, and so the Continental Constitution was formed here in Monterey. And they in October of 1849 they had the Constitutional Convention, and I think it was like 51 guys here, and they eventually drafted the Constitution of the State of California in 1849, and I think in May of 1850 California became a state.
And I think we have a picture number 8. I think is of Colton Hall. There it is, right there.
It
looks the same as it did then.
Yeah,
I'm just kidding.
Close, yeah.
That's a recent
actually,
picture.
What's great about Colton Hall, and you go up to the stairs,
yes,
and you look on the rock there, because all that rock was brought in here. They just did, you know, they're actually graffitied in the walls there from the guys who built that thing. And
no.
Yeah, and there were prisoners that did most of it, and you can see it.
I'll be doggone. Yeah. Did they build the jail that's next door, too, or something?
Colton did that part, but there.
Okay. Well, no, they were staying there, probably.
Right, right,
that was their hotel.
Yeah, right, right.
All right. Now, I understood, and correct me if I'm wrong, that invited to this constitutional convention were actually some representatives from Mexico. Is that correct?
Oh, sure, there were. And they were, in fact, well, especially Californios, but they were, yes, they were all here, including Thomas Larkin, John Sutter was part of that whole thing, and the John Fremont, the Pathfinder, was, of course, here as one of the delegates as well. So, yeah, they were very represented.
And also some landowners, some Mexican landowners,
right,
I think, is
right,
what I was trying to say,
right,
were also invited in, even though it was the California Constitution.
Yeah, but they were trying to be, you know, I mean, it's really interesting to me, that whole constitutional thing, in part because one of the things that they adopted, that California would not be a slave state. Yet, as I mentioned, John Sutter was here as one of the delegates, and John Sutter actually was in the business of kidnapping, essentially, native children, Indian children, and selling them to work as indentured servants, you know, in a lot of the homes. A lot of homes in Monterey had those guys doing that kind of thing. But
oh, my goodness, you heard it right here on your town, John Sutter.
He was John Sutter was not a very ethical person. I mean, if you really read about John Sutter, he was a very interesting man.
Now, was this after he had discovered gold then?
Oh, sure.
Okay,
right.
So he already had some money, and I had no idea.
Yeah, well, Sutter, the gold was discovered on the American River in 1848. John Marshall was working for Sutter, and in fact, when they brought that, you know, Sutter wanted to keep him quiet, right? And he sent, don't tell anybody. And in fact, he sent Marshall down here to Monterey to claim all that land. And he brought that gold piece that he found here to Monterey. In fact, to the Larkin House, where they was looked at, and they said, "Well, you can't just take all that land." So,
okay.
In fact, it was Sherman, General Sherman, the famous Civil War general, that was the one who said, "No, you can't claim all that land." And so he was here in Monterey at that time.
Well, I had no idea that he wanted to claim all
that
land.
Oh yeah, he wanted to keep it quiet.
And,
all
of the gold. Isn't that something else? And now we have another picture here of Alvarado Street.
Sure.
So this was, we were talking about the Constitution in the mid 1800s.
Yeah, yeah.
This is, I think, about 1890, I believe, is what this was categorized as. And that's Alvarado.
You're looking down from the Custom House, right?
Right. And so it was, is that a railroad track running?
Trolley car.
A trolley car. And what was going on in downtown Monterey
at that point?
Then?
So Monterey was pretty, you know, Monterey was a really rough and tumble place. I mean, it was really the Wild West.
Okay.
I mean, there were hangings and shootings and lots of saloons, and it was a tough place to live. You know, and main reason that after they signed the Constitution, there's one of the myths about Monterey, that Monterey was the first capital of California. Well, it was not. I mean, because once they signed the Constitution, they actually moved the capital, I think, initially to San Jose, and then it went to Benicia and went all over different places. But mainly because they felt, and this is their words, that Monterey was a Mexican town, and they wanted to get away from that whole idea of it. Monterey, Mexico, the Mexican language, the Spanish language, was spoken in Monterey up to the turn of the last century. That was the major language that was here. And so it was beginning, at the point of that picture was taken, mm-hmm. really beginning to start to get more Americanized as other European immigrants started coming into the Monterey area because of the fishing industry and other things really began to change.
Can we go to picture 10, please, Jim? Now, there's a picture here of the Custom House, and this was taken around 1900,
right.
I believe.
Right.
And now, a Custom House here, was this a big port where enough people coming in, or what?
Well, the Custom House, of course, as you know, is just a tax house. That's the whole
right.
point of it.
Mm-hmm.
So when this was part of Spain, Spain closed these ports. I mean, they didn't let ships come in here.
Oh.
It was a very difficult place to live. And you know, I mean, literally, it was like living on a deserted island. You know, I mean, you relied on this one supply ship that'd come once a year, you know, to bring you the things
wow.
that you love. When this 1822, when Mexico declared its independence from Spain, this became part of Mexico. They opened the port and built that Custom House.
Oh,
and
okay.
Of course, they would tax those ships that were coming in, bringing cargo, and sometimes up to 100% of their cargo. So that's what those Custom House was all about. I mean, then after we became part of the United States, the United States ran it as a Custom House for several years, and
mm-hmm.
then I believe in the 1870s they closed it down, and it sort of was abandoned for a while, and fishermen took it over. In fact, early Italian fishermen were living in that building. They were building their nets on that porch there.
Wow.
And you can see in this that picture they showed, where you can see the little white houses behind the Custom House.
Sure.
The little houses that are down on Cantor Row, they call the workers' shacks. That's those houses.
Okay.
There were 1.60 of those little houses that stretched all the way from the Cantor Row all the way down to the Monterey Wharf.
I'll be doggone.
Yeah.
You know, and now, there's a type of shellfish.
Right.
That was really popularized. And now I believe that the Chinese and Japanese
right.
were hunting abalone,
right.
But it didn't really get popular, at least around here
right.
Or in other areas, until a gentleman came up. Could we go to, I think it's number, 12, 11?
Okay. There's
Pop Ernst. I don't know if that's a menu or something.
That's a famous menu that he had. He was a master at marketing himself in his restaurant.
Okay.
And this menu was done by two very, very well-known Monterey, California artists. The middle section done by a guy named Joe Mora, and the outer section
wow.
done by a guy named Armin Hansen. And they both did it for free abalone dinners. and Pop Ernest Dolter, I've been working on a book about Pop for a couple of years now.
Really?
He is actually the center of the universe in the Monterey fishing industry.
Okay.
For all the things that he, because of this one little recipe that he helped develop.
Sure.
The abalone recipe really just sort of changed the Monterey fishing industry.
Well, let's go to 12. Let's go to picture 12. Because then people can really see what
yeah,
Pop,
there he is, right there.
He is
yeah.
right there. Tell us about what, I mean, how it
right.
started and
well,
how
he
got things going.
He was a German restaurateur
mm-hmm.
and was in San Francisco for several years before coming to Monterey.
Right.
In fact, he was kind of a gypsy in a way. I mean, he worked at different restaurants in in San Francisco, and ran his own places in San Francisco. And it turned the last century. He was in Stockton, where he mm-hmm. had he and his family had it was like a petting zoo and a beer garden kind
wow.
of thing. And then he ran a hotel in Gilroy. Then came to Monterey about 1908, mainly because in Gilroy they raised his liquor license fee, so he left and opened a small restaurant on Alvarado Street. That was around this time. The Japanese had been here in Monterey about 10 years at that point, and Japanese diving abalone at that point. Nobody wanted abalone then. Hey, what do you do with it, right?
Right.
Unless you prepare it properly, it's like eating a rubber boot, right?
Mm-hmm.
The Japanese were drawing it and shipping it back to Asia and to China and to Australia and other places. And so Pop figured, why no one's eating this stuff? So he brought it into his restaurant and experimented with it and came up with this famous recipe where you slice the foot, because that's what you're eating when you're eating abalone, is the foot. Pound it to make it nice and soft,
mm-hmm.
then you run it through egg wash, cracker crumbs, and cook it up quickly in olive oil. And soon people came from everywhere to eat abalone steaks in his restaurant. And they would sing songs and write poetry like, some folks boast the quail on toast because they think it's Tony, but I'm content to owe my rent and live on abalone.
Isn't that something?
So, actually, a woman named Opal Heron wrote that poem, and then but it was recorded into Pop's guest books by a guy named George Sterling, a famous California poet, in 1913. And then Monterey raised Pop's liquor license fee about 1913, and he said, "The heck with you," and he packed up his family and his abalone recipes and moves back to San Francisco.
Okay.
Works at a restaurant called the Hofbräu, which was on the corner of Market and 4th Street. Became the first really mainstream restaurant to put abalone on its menu. But still, it was a pretty tough sell in those days.
So to speak.
And then in 1915, of course, the World's Fair came to San Francisco. It's called the Panama Pacific. It was a big World's Fair to open, to honor the opening of the Panama Canal that opened a few years before. And World's Fairs in those days were very special things.
Sure.
You know, and every state was represented, every state. And Castaic, California had the largest of the state buildings. It was 5 acres in size. Every county would set up a special business to represent their county. And the business that Monterey County sent up was the Point Lobos Monterey Abalone Company. So 1913, the state of California passed a law saying the Japanese could not export abalone out of California.
Okay.
So really, what were they going to do?
Mm-hmm.
And so they were looking for ways to market this to the Western audiences. So this was a great opportunity for them. And they were so they were giving away samples of canned abalone, working with Pop Ernest, because he was buying the abalone for the Hofbräu for those from those guys, and they were sending folks down to the Hofbräu for free abalone or for full abalone steak dinners.
Right.
And then soon the whole world wanted this product.
Oh boy.
You know, and so Pop moved back to Monterey. Eventually, he works out of Point Lobos for a couple of years, working as a broker, brokering abalone steaks to hotels and restaurants, developed the process to ship it, to keep it fresh. Moved back to Monterey, down to the wharf, comes the very first restaurant on the Monterey Wharf, was his restaurant, initially called The Club, because it was in the old Monterey Yacht Club. Then he changed the name to Pop Ernest, became known as the Abalone King. In fact, they had two restaurants in that building.
Okay.
So there was a lower level that catered to the working class, and upper level that catered to the Hotel Del Monte class.
Well, since we're kind of on the subject of fish, let's move over to Cannery Row. And, you know, the name is in the name of your business.
Right,
I know you're quite a historian.
Right.
When did they start to sell things over in Cannery Row? I mean, was it the canneries first or what?
Well, of course. I mean, Cannery really developed. In fact, it didn't, by the way, officially become Cannery Row until 1958.
Oh.
Always was Ocean View Boulevard.
Okay.
But always referred to as Cannery Row.
Okay.
So the earliest reference I've ever seen to it being called Cannery Row appeared in a local newspaper in 1919. Unfortunately, we don't know who that writer was that coined that phrase, because guys just didn't get bylines in those days. But it really began to develop as Monterey's fishing industry began to develop. Initially, the very first sardine cannery was F.E. Booth's sardine cannery, which was adjacent to the Monterey Wharf. He came initially for salmon. It was Japanese fishermen doing all that business. Then because of World War I, because all that salmon they were canning here was mostly going to Europe, and then all the sardines they were eating in that time were coming from Europe, and because of the war, just they couldn't ship and they couldn't export, so they just switched, and they began to heavily fish sardine along the west coast here. There was big plans to develop sardine counters all along the waterfront from about where the almost where the Hotel Del Monte is, all the way along the waterfront here.
Really?
And the Hotel Del Monte folks were very unhappy with this idea because they were convinced if you have canneries along the waterfront, then no other tourists aren't going to come.
Mm-hmm.
So they actually passed these petitions around to stop this whole business from even starting.
Uh-huh.
And so, but the city of Monterey, pretty smart. They said, wait a minute, there is money to be made here. And so they said, all right, all you canneries can go way down there at the end of Ocean View Boulevard where nobody goes. That's how Cannery Row becomes Cannery Row.
Okay.
The Booth could stay where he was because he was already there. And so the very first cannery on Cannery Row was a cannery called Monterey Fishing Canning Company, Japanese-owned guy named Otto Sabaru Noda, who was really responsible for bringing abalone divers, salmon fishermen, and then opened the very first cannery on Cannery Row, Japanese guy.
Boy, he was an entrepreneur, huh?
Well, he was an amazing person, yeah.
Now, Cannery Row so often is associated with John Steinbeck,
sure.
You know, the book by that name. What was the Cannery Row of Steinbeck's Cannery Row like? What was it? What was it like?
You know, if you have to separate fact from fiction, right?
Okay.
So the book is a wonderful book, and I tell everybody to read that book. I highly recommend it, but they are works of fiction, right? Loosely based on real people, mm-hmm. but they're really not about cannery workers or about sardine fishermen. But the real Cannery Row was a hard-working place. I mean, at one time there were 19 canneries along that waterfront there. Every cannery had hundreds of employees within those canneries. You worked 10, 12, 15 hours a day, 6 days a week. It was a tough place to work.
Wow.
Yeah.
Now, and could we bring up picture 15? This is something that I did a lot of research because I know that you knew you were coming on, and that of course is John Steinbeck, right? And his sister,
right.
And that was 1909.
Right.
And we're gonna go out on this note. But I wanted to show everybody a picture they may not have seen before. Tim, again, tell the audience the name of your business and how they can best get in touch with you.
Monterey Waterfront Cannery Row Tours. It's a walking tour. I do walking tours daily, not just of Cannery Row, but also Monterey Cemetery. I do a tour on Abalone. And beginning in the next couple of weeks, I'll be starting an actual old Monterey, historic Monterey walking tour, working with the Monterey Marketplace people, opening the place down the train station down there.
Wonderful.
So you can get in touch with me. Email me at timsardine@yahoo.com. That's pretty easy to remember. timsardine@yahoo.com.
Okay.
And you can then through there find my website and everything else.
All right. We're looking forward to it. And we are going to take a short break. And we'll be back with Chris Scholin from Mbari. Tim, thanks for coming down.
You bet. Thank you.
Okay.
Just a moment with more of the Your Town television program here on AMP's cable channel 24 and on the internet at ampmedia.org. Just a moment with more of the Your Town television program here on AMP's cable channel 24 and on the internet at ampmedia.org.
Welcome back to the Your Town television program. My name is Steve Ellzey. I'm the executive producer for AMP, and I'm here with you every second Monday of the month, and that's today, and I guess that's why I'm here. With us right now in the studio, right across from me, is the chief executive officer of the Monterey Bay Aquarium Research Institute. Some of you know it as Mbari. Chris Scholin. Chris, welcome to the program.
Thanks, Steve. It's a pleasure to be here.
Now, we're going to talk about the next generation of tools for ocean science and research. And I probably didn't say that right, but I know how to segue out of it. David Packard had a vision when he founded Mbari, so to speak. Could you tell us a little bit about what was in his mind?
Well, I think his vision for Mbari grew out of his experience developing the aquarium.
Mm-hmm.
And it really gave him a chance to see the kind of tools that marine scientists work with. You know, we were still dragging nets. We still do drag nets. And pretty primitive and limited means for accessing the deep ocean. And so there had to be a better way, I guess. Let's put it that way.
Mm-hmm.
And being the technologist and the engineer that he was, what better way than to merge engineering and science and develop new tools and methods for studying the ocean?
You know, I had noticed that in the 2012 annual report for MBARI, you talk about your technology roadmap for the future, and part of this is the Rachel Carson.
Right.
And you know, I think if we've got a picture number two or something, I actually found a picture of the Rachel Carson. I think I found some that weren't the Rachel Carson.
Our Rachel Carson,
yeah.
The Rachel Carson.
Yeah. And anyway, Jim, if you could bring up that Chris 2 photo, and that's the Rachel Carson. Tell us how that fits into the technology roadmap then.
Well, we're really about accessing the ocean. Mm-hmm. We have to get to sea. And previously, we had a couple of ships that allowed us to access the coastal ocean. A day boat that was called the Point Lobos, and it served us well for near 25 years.
Mm-hmm.
And an ex-San Francisco pilot boat known that we called the Zephyr. And those two ships were wonderful, but they each had their own specialty. And as changing economic times, we had to find a way to merge the best of those two worlds. And that was in the Rachel Carson. So it allows us to do the same thing that two different boats had did in the past.
And now that will go up and down the coast. And for some reason, I thought it could also go out into the ocean proper. I mean, many, many miles off the coast.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's a very capable boat. It has tremendous range capability. But you can't seep a lot of people on board. And so it has a relatively limited use in terms of long duration missions. But it's a very capable boat nonetheless.
Okay. Now, Chris, and forgive me, I'm a novice, but I was looking at these new technologies for ocean science, and I kept seeing the acronym ROV and AUV,
right.
And you know, and it seemed to me like that was the type of technology that MBARI was very integral in developing, but it's still around. Tell me about that.
The remotely operated vehicle for ROV,
mm-hmm.
We really owe our heritage there to David Packard. So it was David who said, you know, we should put robots in the ocean, not necessarily people. It's cheaper, it's safer, you spend more time down there. And so it was his push to develop this technological approach to accessing the ocean that gave us the ROVs.
Mm-hmm.
ROVs are tethered to the ship, so it's like having a robot at the long end of an extension cord, and there are your eyes and hands and allow you to do things in the ocean. The autonomous vehicles, the AUVs, are like smart torpedoes. So they're free from the ship, you let them go, they navigate themselves, and then come back. So they're very different types of tools. ROV is very targeted in how mm-hmm. you use it. The AUV is like a survey tool. It can run out, do a lot of things for you, retrieve samples for you, and then bring it back home.
And how about the ESP, which, tell us about that.
Oh, the ESP. Well, that was another pipe dream many years ago, like a lot of these technologies. You mm-hmm. know, they have their roots that are years ago in the past. But there, the idea was that scientists were constantly having to bring a sample of water back to the laboratory where you would perform all kinds of tests.
Mm-hmm.
And the idea was pretty simple and maybe naive at the time, was why not just have robots do that in the ocean for you? So the ESPs is really about detecting microorganisms using DNA probe technology, identify the species and give you a sense of their abundance and activities.
And this happens on the in the ocean or on the ocean floor? Where does all that
take
place?
Yeah, in the ocean, on the ocean, all over or on shore.
In fact,
we have a couple of machines right now mm-hmm. sitting in a shellfish farm up in Puget Sound, and they just have pipes that run out into the shellfishery growing area. And on the tide, when the tide floods, it takes a sample of water and it looks for pathogens and things that'll affect the seafood. And then it puts that data on the web.
Okay, all right. Another fascinating technology I was reading about is tracking schools of fish, or
right.
I don't know if they're doing it with drones or what.
That's right, yeah. It's drones have come to ocean science. That's
wow.
right. Yeah, it's really a pretty phenomenal idea. But it's all about being there and following mm-hmm. these animals in space and over time is a very challenging thing to do if you were in a boat chasing them.
Mm-hmm.
And so the idea is pretty simple. You put a tag or some way mark the animal, and then you allow robots, these drones, to follow them and report on their position, and it allows people to study them without necessarily being there in person.
And now, and Chris, what puzzled me is that I saw that something taking place off the coast of Portugal, but I also thought I saw something where Imbari was involved in tagging some sunfish or something. Were you all involved with that type of experiment?
Yes, yeah, we have been involved in those kinds of things. It's tagging fish, chasing them, that's not our typically what we would do as a mainstream
right.
activity, but we've been providing the technology to help utilize that tag and utilize these platforms for following these animals.
All right, now, some more pictures from the ROVs and maybe the AUVs, I don't know, but you did kind of what I thought was fascinating, because I know about marine debris. You looked at what litter or trash what was doing at various levels, mm-hmm. water levels. Tell us about where'd that come from?
Well, that's a fascinating story. The whole issue of marine debris has really heated up lately, and people mm-hmm. Realize that although far from land and far from sight, there is quite a bit of trash that we put into our oceans.
Right.
And the ability to understand that and document that, though, really grew out of from David Packard's vision of having a system that could record video, archive that information, and later in the future you can query that and ask questions about what have you seen in the past. Now, of course, it was done to study marine animals and all sorts of things,
mm-hmm.
but along the way we realized we were seeing trash and people began to document this. And so, fast forward 20 years and you mm-hmm. now have a way of looking in the past and saying, what are we seeing, where did we find trash, what kind of trash, classifying it, and that's how that study grew. So it was never really a project per se.
Mm-hmm.
We set out to document marine debris, but it was noticed, and so we used the tools that we had to show just how much debris is in our own bay.
Okay. Jim, can we go to number six, please? It's picture number six, which is a tire, you know, it looks like there's something growing on it.
Right.
Okay. I don't know if that's an anemone or some sort of organism. But
right.
what I found fascinating is I was fortunate enough to go along with the sanctuary folks, and they went to some crab traps that Imbari had found, and then you had the coordinates on them, and then they were the ship was able to go out and then pull these things up because it was phantom fishing.
Yeah.
So that was sort of an outgrowth of this technology where you see things and then you started recording where the marine debris was, and it was a really wonderful symbiosis to see that work. This was probably something that you had recorded many, many years or months before that, and here then they were able to use an ROV to find it,
right.
grab a hold of it, and bring the thing up. Fascinating.
Yeah, that's right. And now some of that detection technology is moving to these autonomous underwater vehicles, so it's possible to fly a survey and identify things on the sea bottom, know where they are, and then come and take a very close look using ROVs. So we've been doing that kind of work.
Mm-hmm.
And it really is, again, I think a testament to this technology in development that started many, many years ago. And it's remarkable what we can do. In fact, in Southern California this past spring, there was that type of mission taking place where there was a survey looking at a suspected chemical weapons dump site.
Cool.
And one of the targets that they found, and this is a sonar image, a little bump on the seafloor, they went to examine it, and it was a package of Nine Lives cat food. So it's pretty remarkable that you could pick up these very small things on the seafloor and then very precisely navigate to them and investigate, exactly what they are.
Now, what about did you do a survey with the ROVs of a ship? Was it the Macon?
That's right, an airship, the Macon, yeah.
Okay, that was off that sank off the coast here.
Mm-hmm, right off the Big Sur coast.
And then what about, didn't you also do one on a tank? tanker? Was there a tanker that sank or a?
Yeah, that's the Montebello off of Cambria. Right, that was an oil tanker that was sunk in World War II, I believe, and there was concern that it still has its cargo on board and it might start leaking oil. And so that was part of our role, was to investigate the ship and its integrity and the seafloor that it's sitting on and whether that's a stable piece of bottom or not.
And what did you find out?
That was fascinating. Yeah, the ship is there. You can find it. We have it in our images are available on Embari's website and so forth.
Okay.
And but the ship is it appears to be in relatively good shape considering it's a wreck. But the more importantly, the seafloor there appears to be stable, and so much of the seafloor along our coast is not very stable. But it's sitting in a fairly sturdy patch of ground.
Now, I have heard the ocean compared to the space exploration, you know. And with space exploration, it seemed like the R&D that went into that and the things they built ended up in our everyday lives. Mm-hmm. Is that happening with ocean exploration and the development of tools to explore the oceans?
You know, I think so, but maybe in an indirect way you don't realize. Some of the things that that we pursue do find their way into everyday life, but it might be in a support role. The oil and gas industry uses technologies and vice versa, the biomedical industries. And I think also for education and just being able to get out these images of what's in our oceans and reveal some of the workings of the planet is another way that some of that technology comes back to people.
Sure. I also read something about a project down in La Jolla, and they're building a new lab down there.
Right.
And I have to read this. It's Ocean Technology Development Tank. What does that mean? I mean, what are they doing? Are they building things under the water or what?
Oh, it's a big swimming pool. Wonderful. Yeah. But Embari has one of these too, and it's really about measure twice, cut once. So it's all about testing and evaluation. When you put things in the ocean, it's a really challenging thing to do. It's a hostile mm-hmm. environment, and so having these test tanks allows you to evaluate your equipment before you go out to sea, spend a lot of money and time, and put it on the seafloor and have mm-hmm. it not work.
Sure.
So it's really for test purposes.
And now Now, here I thought, this was something new. You have one at Embari and have probably had one for a long time then.
For some time, we have, mm-hmm. yeah, and it's a very important part of our R&D cycle. When we have equipment that's ready to go, we'll put it in the tank. You might look at, its weight, say, underwater, or whether it's functioning properly electrically, mm-hmm. And so forth.
Okay. I also noticed that, and I'd never seen this in my Google searches before, that all of a sudden there's a lot of activity, the UK and Canada, a lot of ocean technology going on over there. Is there a worldwide effort? Is there any organizations? Is there like an international space station under the water or
right.
in progress
right.
or what?
Well, in a manner of speaking, yes, there are huge annual meetings, oceans meetings that bring technologists together, and they're academics and people from industry. So it's an enormous industry,
mm-hmm.
and those folks also coordinate some of their activities. So there are large projects that are ongoing to build observatories for the ocean and the deep sea, and as well as the water column. And so it's really about getting access and putting our finger on the pulse of the planet. That's sort of what those things are about.
Okay. Now, what about a blue economy? The Monterey Institute has a certification in the blue economy. What's that? What's that about?
Well, to me, it's common sense. It's about mm-hmm. sustainability. And
okay.
So the idea of a blue economy is just that the things that you do are, you're acting as if you're part of the ecosystem rather than being separate from it. That's the way I would look at it.
Mm-hmm.
But it also has to make economic sense. People
mm-hmm.
won't do it if it doesn't turn the economy. And so really, I think it's an investment in our thinking. It's a change in the way we interact with our environment, whether you be on land or sea. We have to find a way to live sustainably on our planet.
And When I was talking to a congressman, I'll keep it at that, he was talking about a marine economy,
right.
A marine science economy. Do you foresee jobs growing out, more and more jobs growing out of what we're doing now?
Well, it's a huge economy here in the Monterey Bay Area,
mm-hmm.
With all the institutions. So it's a big part of our economy. However, there are outgrowths, I think, in some of the tools and techniques that we develop are exported to other sectors, like oil and gas, as an example. Marine protected areas and the expansion of that, and how that will feed back into, say, sustainable fishing, for example. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot to be gained, I think, by coordinating our activities and looking to see how we can export that beyond just knowledge creation. It's really much more than that. It's how we can take the blue economy as a great example. How can we live more sustainably with the resources we have?
Chris, we've got about 25 seconds. Tell us just a little story about how you really got sparked up about the ocean.
Jacques Cousteau. It's all about Jacques Cousteau, right? Love those TV specials.
The late night TV you used to watch?
Late night TV, right. Had to sneak out from bed to peek out from under the, around the corner and see it on that little black and white.
Oh, so many people need to be touched, I bet.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for coming on and visiting with us. We hope you come back again.
My pleasure, Steve. Thanks
okay.
for having me. Bye-bye.
All right. And we will be back, well, the second Monday of September, but Your Town Television is here 5 days a week. From 5 p.m. to 6 p.m. every Monday, there's Your Health from 4 p.m. to 5 p.m. Want to thank you so much for watching on AMP24. Remember, you can watch us again at midnight, you know, if you thought it was really entertaining. So we'll see you again.
Thank you very much for joining us today on the Your Town Television program here on AMP's Cable Channel 24 and on the internet at ampmedia.org. Don't forget, the Your Town Television program is on every weekday afternoon at 5 o'clock. For more information about the Your Town Television program, go to our website, montereyradio.com. The Your Town Television program is produced by Jim and Mary Lou Vossen under montereyradio.com. Thank you very much for joining us today.